meeting of the Rochester Common Council for June the 27th to order, and our first order of business is the Pledge of Allegiance. And Councilman Thompson, would you lead us in the pledge?
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Chase. It's kind of like church, Chase. I feel like it just come on one up front. Okay, did everybody have a chance to read the minutes from the meeting of May 23rd? If so, I would entertain a motion to accept the minutes.
So moved.
Mason, that motion. Chase seconded. Those in favor, raise your right hand. It's 4-0. Thank you. And the Board of Public Works and Safety meeting minutes, May the 11th, the 25th, for information only. Receive copies of those. Nothing under communications tonight, so we'll move right along to new business. I see we have lots of visitors here this evening. First on our new business is the Optimus Club permit fee waiver requested.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm great, thank you.
Good.
I'm Teresa Hauser, and I'm here tonight, excuse me, to represent the Rochester Optimus Club. I think most of you are familiar already with the Optimus Club. We spend somewhere between $15,000 and $20,000 a year of our earnings on programs for youth in the county, Fulton County. Some of the things that we have supported in the last year or two are the pavilions for the girls' softball at Blackadder. Many clubs and many sports at the area schools. Reading programs, the CASA program. We recently have helped fund the new animal shelter educational center. And the biggest effort we have is our $7,000 in scholarships every year. The way we raise our money is we have two pancake breakfasts. We sell food at the fair. Please come, not next week, but the week after, and order your tenderloin. Our biggest project, though, is that we raise and we sell 10 acres of pumpkins. I think everyone knows that we use Rob Lau's lot over there on East 9th Street. He's kind enough to let us squat there. And recently, one of our club members purchased a building. If you've seen that storage building with a nice porch on it there, he purchased that for us so we have a place that's dry and safe. And I guess we didn't really realize that we needed permits. I called Casey. Anyway, the setbacks were fine, but we do need permits, and the permits were $55. And quite frankly, we prefer to spend the $55 on youth activities and then permits, so that we're asking for a waiver of fees for the size of the building and if we put a sign on it. So that's what we're requesting.
Any discussion or questions from the council? Care to make a motion?
Make a motion we waive the fees.
Second.
Those in favor? 4-0.
Thank you very much.
Also, Teresa, for the record, you mentioned the projects that you contributed to. The Optimists were also very generous to give $5,000 to the 9th and Main Street Park. We want to thank you for that effort, too. Thank you. Okay, next we've got a personal property tax abatement renewal request from American Axle.
I'm not sure, I don't know that they have a representative or Terry.
Terry,
did they speak to you? Okay. This was one of those, the county had contacted me because they weren't sure if we had received the copy. They had received it. So this is kind of a, they can go ahead, they'll process it on their end. It is just personal property, not real property, the investment they made. And so she sent the documentation over, Angie, from the assessor's office. And it is kind of a were kind of behind the deadline to formally receive it, but she said they did not see any reason not to go ahead and offer the tax abatement. She said there was a hiccup with them, that she thinks it was because of the taxable year into the payable year, and she said we think they got, a year was off for them, and I think it was just because of the confusion when they, because they originally applied for a real estate and personal property, found out they did not qualify for the real estate, and then, but they did for the personal property, so I think it just kind of put a hiccup in their system at the assessor's office, but they have since got that straightened out, so this is now moving forward, they'll have, be coming to us every year for renewal on that. I did not spend much time looking at the numbers and making sure that they were within compliance, but.
I don't have that copy here, Sean.
It was a separate email.
What, how do they look for the, thank you, Juan, how do they look for the employee? A little short. Yeah. Terry, I don't want to put you on the spot, but do you have any information regarding their situation?
Yeah, I know they had.
I guess I am putting you on the spot.
That's fine. I know they had indicated they would have 66 employees. I think the last I talked with David, the plant manager, they were under 40. He did follow up later after I met with him back in probably early May and said that they were hoping to get a piece of business that would take them closer to at least the demand for the 66, and he followed up and said they did get that piece of business, so they would be going into a hiring mode pretty soon, but he didn't indicate what that would be in terms of actual employees, so they are looking to add to the facility and bring in more work, but I can't tell you tonight exactly where they are on that.
Thoughts, gentlemen?
Is this something we could approve and attach a warning for following years if numbers continue to not perform?
Well, this was.
I don't know the answer to that.
This is what, the fourth year into this tax abatement?
No.
Third years?
Second, right?
I think 17 payable, 18 would actually be the first year that they would get the deduction.
Right.
Oh.
Because of, and that was part of the, like I said, when they were first did the application and then the real estate tax abatement operates on a different payable year than personal property, as Andrew was explaining. So I believe is actually the first year, or last year would have been the first year.
Our resolution number was 14-2014.
Right, would have been when they first came to us and we approved it, and that would have been towards the, it would have been, I think it was November or December, it was late in the year.
Late, 14.
I personally think it's just a little bit too early to get too penal with this, that they need a little bit of time to get things moving, improving.
And it's certainly something that next year we could certainly have a conversation with them at the beginning of the year regarding this, and just so that way they're not, we're getting the information early enough that you guys could actually have longer conversation than after the fact. Because I believe this is due back by May 15th to the assessor's office and to our office, because you're the designated body. And you're more than welcome. You can give Angie a call, Angie Whetstone at the assessor's office. She's the one that's handling this particular one. And give her a call and she can give you a little more information on it too.
Marty, I think you can state whatever proviso or warning you want and have it put in the minutes. Mm-hmm. I don't think what you can do is you can't condition whether the council approves a similar compliance statement in the future on something.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. Because I mean, could be in theory binding future council members, which you really can't do.
Which, that could be something we could write on, I think, under the other, instead of, because on here you can either, it's in substantial compliance, is not in substantial compliance, or other. And in the other, we could put that it's being approved in compliance, however, you know, concerned with the numbers or the requirement or their specifications, how would we want to do that?
Projected specifications.
Yes. So we could do that as well.
And I know they're aware of this. I went to see them about 9 months ago, and the mayor walked in the door, the first thing they wanted to know if it was to discuss the tax abatement. I said, no, just really to come in and see what you're all about. Terry, correct me if I'm wrong, but most of their work comes from a sister plant. They're right. Doing tier two work to a sister plant. They're not right. Doing it for customers coming directly to them.
No,
so
right.
They're kind of restricted on the amount of work for the home office, what they're
for
being
the
sent from
the sisters. Of the company, yeah.
Sisters. Yeah.
Well, if you're aware of the situation, they're aware of the situation. I don't know that we need any caveat on the motion. I'll make a motion to approve the continuance of the abatement.
Do we have a second?
No second.
Marty's made the motion and Mason seconded. Those in favor signify by raising your right hand. And it's 4-0. Okay. We'll keep an eye on that. Oh, wow, here's new business. Clerk Treasurer Beeler for Casey Coles.
I know. She called in a favor. you guys have, there's a map that is laying up there. Casey had texted me earlier, and at the Area Planning Commission meeting last night, they met and they were discussing the Flying J, the new truck stop coming in, and some traffic concerns and things like that. So they asked her to bring it in front of the council, that a request, and they're also going to do this. Her and I are going to coordinate letters. But essentially what it boils down to is, on your map, their concern is the traffic light that's there at the Rochester Crossing coming out of Walmart does not have a left turn light. And they want they're concerned about that, especially with the increase in traffic with the truck stop coming in. So they would like for NDOT to make that a left turn, an arrow going left, south onto 25 from the east, from the Rochester Crossing Drive. And then they also would like to have a right turn lane installed going north on 25. They're turning east onto Rochester Crossing Drive. So, because again, you're going to have we're going to have more truck traffic, large tractor trailers and things like that. So they would prefer not to impede and the truck flow on 25 headed north at that intersection, especially with the way the off ramp is. I mean, it's all right there.
Oh, it's going to be a concern.
Yeah. And so she is asking or requesting a letter of support from the council in regards to send to NDOT, trying for them to be proactive with this request to educate them on what our concerns are. So she was just asking for support from the council in that. And again, she and I will draft the letters so that we're speaking the same language and the same documentation going with it. And then I will also be bringing the same request to the Board of Works and to the mayor's office. And I think if we can, those three bodies in the mayor's office, or the two governing bodies in the mayor's office, can send a letter, plus the Area Plan Commission will send one, that maybe we can get NDOT to come in and take a look at it, and hopefully
they won't say that's a perfect spot for a J-turn.
Exactly, because
yes.
That's
yes.
Another letter she's
yes.
Sending. So that was their other concern. And they do intend, they will be closing on that property July 10th. And so she said, don't be concerned if you start seeing ground movement on July 11th.
They're in a hurry. Yeah.
They were, the Planning Commission, you know, was almost tabled this because they wanted, they were concerned about it, and they decided not to, because she said, wait, I think we need to keep moving forward. They're wanting to get their business rolling here and get moving. They're really itching to get that up and running. So with that, and what I will do is if the council, if it pleases the council, we'll get the draft letter. I will get that email to you guys for thoughts, concerns, approval, and then we can get that sent off. We'll get that off to you before the next council meeting and make sure that you guys are comfortable with what we're wording it.
Well, we can put the formal letter out too, but we also open up some discussions by telephone about it too, to the different MDOT.
And we felt, yeah, and we felt probably starting with your office in that regard, get that conversation rolling.
Go right to the commissioner and get all rolling there.
Correct.
It is going to be a concern.
Mm-hmm. Very much so. And especially because, again, it's the increase with, you think about the tractor trailers, you know, you get two or three of them right there, you're backed up waiting on that light. And it's kind of that intersection, that light, the way they have it striped now is a little kooky, for lack of a better way to put it. Matter of fact, Chief Schatz was in my office when we were talking about it, so he was hearing her discuss this as well as we were chatting, so he's been brought up to speed on that too.
Any questions or comments?
Did Casey say that MDOT had any concerns there? No.
Nothing has been reached out to them. We're trying to be proactive with MDOT and get them rolling on this before the truck stop gets completed. If we can get them involved now,
asking them to open up the discussions.
Yes.
I didn't know if they had any reason to approve or not approve, if they had any leeway that way, I guess.
No, I don't think, they're not aware of it as of yet. Okay. That's what we're starting that awareness campaign.
Okay.
Entertain a motion to allow the area planning commissioner and city hall to move forward with that, to reach out to MDOT.
A second. Makes a lot of sense to me.
Yeah, it's going to be an issue.
Yeah,
it's going to be an issue. Those in favor signify by raising your right hand, and that's a 4-0 also. You know, you're a pretty amicable group tonight. We need to tell the other three of us.
Well, be careful, right?
Okay, thank you, Shada.
You're welcome, thank you. Casey, thank you.
Casey. No unfinished old business.
I do have old business. I did miss that on the agenda. The letters for the dedications. I have the map with all the signatures for Rochester Housing, as well as the utilities. That has all been completed. It is all done, signed, sealed, literally delivered. So I will put that in the vault. She will get it recorded at the recorder's office, so that it now is in the city's inventory.
Okay, great.
Sorry, thank you.
So let's move on down to the department reports then. We'll start with Fire Chief Butler.
Good evening. I wish you a copy of the main report in front of them.
Good evening, John.
How's everyone? Good. Structure fires, two in the city, one in Rochester Township. Grill fire, one in the city. Vehicle fires, one in the city. Auto fire alarm, one in the city. Brush fire, one in the city. Mutual aids, one to Libby Township, three to Henry Township, two to Abenaki Township. Calls for smoke, one in the city. Gas leaks, two in the city, one in Rochester Township. Gasoline spills, one in the city. Accidents, three in the city, three in Rochester Township. Drove the ambulance once from the accident scene. Medical assists, 24 in the city, 11 in Rochester Township, two in Richland Township. Drove the ambulance four times. And we had a mock prom accident at the high school in the city, and then we did prom parking. A total of 63 runs and one drill. Also, for your information in being stewards of the financial dollar, all the vehicles have been serviced for the year. Pumps will be serviced and tested late summer, early fall, and Tower 6, the aerial will have its tower inspection and tested this fall, waiting on appointments on all those last tests by the vendors. Pending your questions, that concludes my report.
Thank you. Any questions for the chief? Thanks, Tom. Okay, Chief Schatz.
Good evening.
Evening, Andy.
For the month of May, we had a total of 21 accidents in the city. Two of those were personal injury. We issued 119 warnings. 30 of those were city ordinance warnings, mostly for grass, weeds, those type of complaints.
And thank you very much for that, Chief. That is a tough thing to go.
It's not glamorous, but it needs done.
Thank you very much.
78 total offenses, 52 case reports, 819 calls for service, 35 lockouts, 8 towed vehicles, and 21 people incarcerated. And then you have the crimes that those people were locked for. Other than that, the Board of Works did hold interviews for police officer applicants last Thursday, and we made a conditional offer to two of those individuals, Kyle Perkins and Matthew McIntyre. Kyle is local, Matthew's from Logansport. We've got to get them down to public safety medical, get them the perp testing, psychological and physical testing done. It will probably be August before they see their first day on the job. Just to give you guys an idea. And then I'm putting the finishing touches on this year's Police in the Park event. It's going to be July 29th, Saturday. It's the last Saturday in July. The movie we're playing this year is Secret Life of Pets. And then the Fulton County Animal Center has agreed to do an adoption event also that night for us. So watch a movie about pets and then take one home. All right.
You know, I love that park program.
It's a good time. It's a good time. It's our third year doing it. Mill Creek Church has agreed to do all the food. They do hot dogs, popcorn, cotton candy, water. They don't charge us anything. They don't charge people anything. I'm trying to make arrangements for a dump tank. Maybe 3 balls for a dollar, and all proceeds go to the animal shelter, something like that. Any more activities for the kids?
Any city council members are welcome.
Absolutely. Or elected officials.
No.
You need to.
Yeah. Are we going to have a fire truck out there?
Yeah, fire truck will be there.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Thanks, Chief. Wonderful.
That's about all I have, unless you guys have any questions.
Anything for the chief? I would like to say that, and again, this is attributable to you, my man. We had 23 applicants for these two police officers' positions, and it was a tough go getting them down to a handful. They were very, very qualified people, the best group we've seen in ages. And the credit to Andy, half a dozen of them or so said that the reason they were applying for the Rochester Police Force, all the good things they were hearing about our
departing lifeguard.
I can't take credit for that. Surround yourself with good people and put your job party.
Well, you've done well, Chief. You really have.
We are in a unique position with the third applicant that didn't get the offer. We've agreed that if there's an opening in the next opening, we'll give him a call and see if he's available or something. Right. So,
Very qualified.
3 good applicants.
Thanks, Andy.
Thank you.
Okay. Did I see Warren? Randy's here. Okay. Randy.
Evening,
Randy.
At the wastewater, we did our normal, the lab did their normal testing. We also tested at Plow for BOD, phosphorus, ammonia, suspended solids. The plant we mowed, we flushed trickling filter number 2. We mowed a house on Indian Avenue that was on the list. Collections, We did our locates. We've mowed lift stations. We jetted Sunset Drive, Jefferson Street, and West 9. Stormwater, Dunny is going to initiate hydraulic modeling, and the elevation from geotechnical is done. I've attached a Gantt chart, and the top part of the Gantt chart is for the stormwater. 7th Street, the 7th Street Sewer Project, we had a reconstruction meeting with Commonwealth and Burcott, and I got a call from Jim Burcott last week. They changed start date to January or July 10th. They've had an issue with the boring crew, but he assured me that the finish date will still be mid-September, just as it was.
That's the important thing.
Fourth Street, we signed a service agreement with Donahue. They're going to work on putting together our information needed for the community crossing grant. And at the bottom of the Gantt chart is the one for the Fourth Street. So they are working on that. And I've talked to Paul Elling at Donahue this morning about a survey. So we're going to see if I'm maybe starting to get ahead. And then the other, we had a pre-bid meeting for the wastewater treatment plant, phosphorus removal, and Super Nate pumping station that we had that day.
Lots of good work going on here, Randy. Nice stuff. Everybody can glean from this. We've got about three major projects going here that involve improving our infrastructure and making Rochester a better place. The storm sewer project will kick in about 2019 is what the projected date for breaking ground and making some progress in that area. But again, I want to remind you, the folks that we're taking on a project that hasn't had anything done to it since the streets were cobblestone. And then, of course, the 4th Street project is the industrial street that will be widened. And that kind of dovetails up against this project because it's going to get some drainage along with the improving of the street and sidewalk being added and such out there so that we can continue to promote our industrial park and also improve getting out there to 25. The 4th Street project is putting that together through the Community Crossroads grant. We're looking for $1 million from NDOT, and that is a 25% match. Randy has to put together an asset management plan and such, which he's done an awful lot of work on. And we're using Donahue as a consulting agency in regards to that. So we believe we're going to be very successful in obtaining that grant. So thank you for your hard work there, Randy. Anybody got any questions for Randy? Thank you, sir. Derek Holloway with the Water Department, Superintendent Holloway.
Good evening.
Good evening, Derek.
The Rochester Water Department monthly duties for May of 2017. Red meters, bid orders, repair to replace bad meters, locates, backwash the filter beds, shutoffs, mowed multiple times, ran the weed eater uptown at the old water tower site, and cleaned up all the trash behind the radio station there. Fixed a damaged outside pit at Riddle School. Weeded fire hydrants, installed posts with cement at 920 Rush around a new fire hydrant that was replaced. Shut off and eliminated the overhead fill out the gas pumps. Myself, Randy Wynn, and Randy Carr attended a meeting in Akron on the 25th. Installed new signs at the plant, the garages, the chlorine room, well houses, and tower sites. Digs that were performed, we replaced the fire hydrant at 920 Wabash Avenue. Callouts, Randy Carr was called out on the 16th to 3322 Barrett Road for a customer not having any water. We determined that the curb stop was not on all the way, and it should have been, so that was our our mistake on that. And then Randy Wynn was called out on the 15th at 8:26 p.m. to 1212 Pearl Street for a water leak in the basement. And I believe the water was shut off for that until the repairs were made. Other than that, that's all I got.
Any questions for Gary? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Street Superintendent Lenny Conley. And Park Superintendent. Well, hello.
Hello.
We saved all our questions.
I thought it'd be different.
And what brings you to America's Got Talent?
Out at the street department, we put out picnic tables and barrels for the block party and picked them up. Ran the recycling route. We weeded downtown from 9th to 5th on Main and cleaned up with a sweeper. Patched holes with blacktop. Filled holes in the alleys with millings. We've been sweeping the streets. Chipped and picked up brush. Picked up bags of yard waste, loaded out compost. A lot of people's been taking that, and that's a good thing, getting ready for the
We are turning some compost over now.
Yeah, we are. Randy's been turning it, about every week or two, Randy? We've been keeping it turned.
I mean, but we have some people coming.
Oh, yeah, they've been taking it, yes.
Good.
Yeah. And We took the chipper to Fort Wayne. They had a recall on the wiring harness, and they put all new wiring harness on it. And while we had it there, we just went ahead and had the 500-hour service done because it was pretty expensive getting in the tanks and changing filters and all sorts of stuff. So we just had them do that while they had it. And we've been watering the flowers and trees downtown. And that's all I have for the street business. And But out in the park, we've been power washing Manitow Mountain, getting ready to seal it back up again for the winter. And we've got her installed on all of our pavilions. And they're doing a lot of mowing. We're going to have get some signage together for the Frisbee Golf course that we put out at. And that's about it. I'll say something for Mason.
I have to say something about Lenny. So I don't know if Lenny even knows this. I'm assuming you do, but two of your gentlemen, Rath and Thomas, I was out early on a couple days ago finishing up for the parade and such. They actually redid the stage for the parade on
their
own.
Yeah, that's been done.
Which was absolutely amazing because I did not even know that was going to be done, but I drove in at 3:00 on Friday and I saw that and I could have seriously kissed it because last year Terry and I were out there for hours trying to get that thing all swept with the broom and not get splinters.
No, it was a winter project, was busy work.
That is you guys did such a great job, so thank you for that.
Thank you.
I deserve great gratitude for that.
Thanks, Amy. That's a five man department.
Yeah.
A lot of bases get covered that people don't realize. I received, just for the council's information, I received a rather lengthy letter, nice letter, a week and a half ago, from a retired fire captain from Carmel, Captain Obermeyer, who has purchased John Fry's house over on 12th Street, corner 12th Street there.
Well,
yeah, 12th Pontiac, and he was out just cleaning up his shrubs and stuff, ready to, and he says, here this crew stopped, and a city employee walked up to him and said, you know, we can take these things away for you, you don't, and he was blown away. He said, you think I could get that done in Carmel? There's no way. And he wrote rather a very complimentary letter of Lenny stopped to see him, to welcome him to Rochester, unbeknownst to me. And his crew. So, thank you very much, yes. Sir.
Thank you.
You're ambassadors for Rochester. Thank you very much.
Yes. What we're here for.
Anybody got anything for Lenny?
Oh, and Mark, we are going to get your parking blocks over there at the community center, just swing that blacktop to cure out a little bit before we go putting them in.
Yep, it looks great.
We're going to go, me and the mayor decided to go with the concrete ones rather than the rubber ones or plastic.
Okay.
The mayor's parking stall?
There will be one. There will be one that has Marty painted on it. It'll also have a little blue square on it. We're the same age, right?
Yes.
Last time you looked.
Last time I looked, yes, we are.
Anything else for Lenny? Thanks, Lenny. Appreciate it. Okay, going down to the reports of committees.
Excuse me.
Aaron's not here. Vetco, Councilman Goodwin.
Vetco met June 1st. We're at checking account balance $19,501.92, operating reserve balance $72,535.39. Current projects, the Centennial Park is ongoing. As of June 1st, there was approximately $43,000 needed to be raised in donations. Is that still firm, Terry, or have you received more?
We received a $30,000 grant from the Community Foundation. I just received a $5,000 donation from Dick Belcher today. So based on the numbers I have right now, we're right at fully funded.
Moving on, the theater, the Rochester Theater Group was applying for a OCRA grant through the Community Foundation. But the Community Foundation stipulates that the deeded owner must be the applicant, and Vetco is still the owner of the theater, so the group asked Vetco to apply for the grant for them, and Vetco agreed, so that is in the works. Fulton County, Eagle Township, Cass County, the front end of Eagle Township and Cass County and Logansport applied and were awarded a brownfield assessment grant in 2013, spent down in 2016. They've applied for another grant, received the largest amount, $600,000. The grant has been used to help Nicoplate Trail, Top Industries environmental assessments, and it's really good for phase one, phase two studies. We actually were able to take advantage of that, thanks to Terry pointing that out to me. It was a huge help. Highway 31, as of the first, they were expecting the draft plan from NDOT either June or July. So, not sure that came in yet or not. Work on the Nicoplate Trail continues. The agreement is signed, the environmental reports are being done, and land acquisitions are moving forward. They did, however, find out that no trees can be removed until after October 1st because of the Indiana brown bat season. And that is my report.
The Indiana brown bat.
Yes. The roosting season.
The roosting season.
The roosting season.
Okay. Really hard to predict. They must have great attorneys.
Okay. Any questions?
Can I,
Terry, you got something?
Yeah, can I pop in a little bit now on
sure.
A couple of things?
Sure. Matter of fact, we can jump and let you do the redevelopment commission also.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thank you, Mason, for having me.
Would you yield the floor to him, Councilman?
I guess.
Okay. The grant that that Vetco agreed to apply for was a Community Foundation grant for $20,000 for some fundraising activities, or to work with a consultant for some fundraising to take care of some architectural review that we're going to need, and then also a website. So that's the one that that Vetco is serving as the applicant for. The OCRA grant, Brian mentioned, is actually a grant that, and I have Natalie Garrick and Renee Fringer and Emily Gottschalk with me tonight from the theater group, from the theater board, and we want to talk to the city about being an applicant for the OCRA grant. that if you grab the packet of information I dropped off right before the meeting, you'll see is the Public Facilities Program grant opportunity. The only applicants for that grant can be the city, a town, or the county. The city doesn't have any open grants open right now. We have, as always, it seems, a short timeline to turn this thing around. September 1st is the application due date. Stephen Ray with the Regional Plan Council is going to serve as the grant writer and also the grant administrator. Shada, you're welcome.
Thank you.
If the city agrees to serve as the applicant, what's involved in that is flip through that. There's a half a dozen papers that the mayor has to sign. One of the things we have to do is repeal the previous resolution declaring slum and blight over the downtown, which was required by OGRA a couple of years ago to apply for one of their other grants. But since this grant will go to a spot project, we have to rescind the previous resolution and then come back in with a new resolution that would declare just the project area that we're talking about, the theater project area, as the slum area that we're affecting by this grant. I talked to Andy about that. He'll do his magic on pulling the paperwork together for probably the next council meeting. The match requirement is a minimum of 10%, so on a $500,000 grant, $50,000. That's not required from the city. Of course, it looks good if the city's actually putting something toward the project. Specifically, it would look good if the city's willing to put something toward the project on a sustainability basis. So an agreement to put something in a budget line item for sustainability, $5,000, $10,000, something a year, starting in 2000, probably 18, maybe even 19, that would show the Office of Community and Rural Affairs that there is a sustainability piece that the city's supporting the project with. I had to run a notice of public hearing this past Saturday in the newspaper. I emailed you guys last week about that. That did run on Saturday, so we do have a public hearing scheduled for this room on July 5th at 6 p.m. And we'll, obviously, that's open to the public. We want public feedback on the city's, hopefully tonight, willingness to move forward as the applicant. I don't think there'll be a good bit of work out of my office on it. It'll be a good bit of work by the board on it, and it'll be a good bit of work from Stephen Ray on it. But we don't really require any city resources other than what the city might look at in their budget to help fund the project. We're hoping that by September 1st, we can pull together private donations. Do we have a goal yet, guys? A couple $100,000 maybe in private donations that we can move forward with the project to be funded. If we're awarded, we'll be awarded in 2017. It'll be 2018 before anything can start. So anything pledged this year won't be spent until 18. And then there's also ineligible project expenses that we won't be able to probably get to even until after construction. The overfunded eligible expenses is over, so those will probably be needed in 2019. What else? That's probably it. If anybody needs any clarification, Dr. Hoff did donate the building last June, July, maybe. Renee, do you remember? No strings attached to FEDCO since we're a 501c3. So if you get a letter from us that would help on his taxes, income taxes. We're holding the building. The funds that the board have raised and the donations we've brought in are taking care of things like just keeping the power on for now. We haven't really had any maintenance expenses on it per se. As the volunteers go in and do some of the tear out activities that would be required. And I've got some contractors that are looking at things like cost to replace the building and cost to replace the sign, work on the marquee out front and so forth. So nobody really sees the work that's going on, but this opportunity came along. At one point in time, it looked like we wouldn't be really looking at this grant this year because we were thinking that there might be a Main Street Revitalization Program grant, is that right? For some streetscape this year, but we decided we can't do that because of the stormwater. So that's been backed off. So but that kind of allows some of the other projects to step up and kind of get in line for this grant availability now. So, questions?
Yeah, we've had, I know you've had discussions too with the committee about the marquee, the real boost to the whole program, monies could be raised to get that marquee in a workable condition, even before anything's done much with the building, start utilizing it to not only dress up downtown, but advertise what's going on with the building and such.
We think the marquee restoration would be one of the eligible expenses under the grant, which means if we're gonna pursue that and use that as an eligible expense, we really are at the mercy of their timeline, which would put us probably late spring, early summer of 18 before, you know, we could put these funds toward it. A couple of things on the grant. Key to our timeline is we have to start an environmental review, which has already started, but the key agency there, the one that is going to offer most of the trip wires for this project, would be the State Historic Preservation Office. So if the city agrees tonight to serve as the applicant for the grant, we're going to engage an architect, Brent Martin, out of Warsaw, who's worked with us on the project all along, to put together the report, send that to SHPO, SHPO, so we can get a letter, basically an acknowledgement back from them that our project meets historic preservation guidelines. If we're successful with our first attempt in submitting that to SHPO, then we should be in line, everything else should be in line for the September 1st application date. If that's returned to us, their turnaround time is 30 days each time. So if we get that information to the State Historic Preservation Office by the second week of July, it'll be the second week of August before we get it back. So at that point in time, we may be cleared. If we're not cleared at that point in time, there's a really good shot we don't get it done in time for September 1st. So in which case, we would just work as the board to be ready for the application in the spring. $500,000 is a lot of money on the project. As we're looking at a total budget of about 1.1 for the project that we have envisioned. And these guys can speak to the future plan of the project and project site if you have any questions for them.
Would you like to hear about the project future plans? Who's the speaker for future plan? Emily, is that you?
Well, the head started this one, so. Okay. Yeah.
Step on up here at the podium if you would.
I don't know if you guys have seen it. I don't know if you have it with your, if you've given it to them, the original ones, the architect's rendering, but.
First of all, identify yourself for the record.
Oh, I apologize. I'm Emily Gottschalk. I'm chairman of the board of the Times Theater Group.
Thank you.
Yeah, the future of the theater is, as it sits right now, it's a 400-seat auditorium theater. Our vision is to have it be a community arts center that can facilitate both stage performances, live-action performances, in way of music, art, you know, drama, but also have capacity to have a drop-down screen to show, like, you know, to show movies. We do intend to buy a projector. That was one of the reasons why the theater originally closed, was not being able to upgrade to the technology that the movie houses now are producing. We do have the south side space, which is about 2,000 square feet, which is just a gem for us as well. We see that space as being very multi-use or reception type things, not necessarily wedding, but really gatherings of city events, private events, the capacity to have it be kind of multi-use. That 600 square foot storefront space that can be, we're kind of thinking maybe an ice cream parlor or something that can be used to kind of come into the lobby or out of the lobby. We do plan to look at what it would look like to increase the lobby size just for, you know, we kind of envision like a community living room, places where families can come to watch movies or adults can come to kind of hang out with their friends. We do, you know, we see it as a real critical piece to downtown and really kind of bringing some businesses back to and kind of keeping, you know, having businesses attract employees to say, hey, we have a theater, we have a place to go watch a movie with the family, or a place to go listen to a symphony, or what have you. So we think it's going to be about, I think it, the most recent estimate was about $1.3 million that we had seen. That doesn't mean we have to get everything right up, you know, right up front. We were able to get this SOCR grant and maybe get, our goal would be a 50% match, so about $250,000 in at least commitments from private donations by September 1st. We feel like we'll probably have almost 75% of the funding available to us, and then from then we can look at kind of closing that gap. But that would allow us to work on the roof that needs replaced, the interiors that are in a state of disarray, and then we can kind of move to the fine touches as we progress. So I share in your desire to have the outside looking a little bit better. We're exploring another grant that is about $15,000 that can be used on outside facades for historical buildings. So we'd love to be able to, again, should we not meet the September 1st deadline, to be able to potentially parlay those funds, should we receive them, to at least get something going, just from a, hey, we're still here, this is what we're doing. I welcome any questions or thoughts, or I just want to have.
I compliment you folks on your efforts, and I, for one, speaking as the mayor, Terry and I have had these conversations. We've had a total focus on the 9th and Main Street project, and now that's going to be off the radar. I think we all ought to be joining arms for the next total focus project on our downtown, because that is our, that's our gateway. That's who we are. I sat down with a couple of Giretti's yesterday who were from Valparaiso, a man and his wife and two little children. They just had moved to Valparaiso a year ago from Texas. And they were on a, let's take a look at Indiana trip. And they were here just by chance coming through Rochester. And we're saying, you know, what a nice, unique, rural community this is. One thing they pointed out, though, was, is the theater, is that someplace we can see a movie? And I said, no, we're working on that. So, well, they said, yeah, it looks a little scarred. Thank goodness they weren't here 2 years ago to see 9th and Main. They were going to Flirt right after lunch, and then over to Schnabeltier's, and then out to Green Oak, and then on to the next place. They were just making a vacation out of it, taking a look at Indiana. We don't know how many people do that. And, getting our best foot out there before, and I don't know, this fellow may come back and put a business in our community at some time. Who knows?
Yeah. So just my history side. So if you all don't know, the theater was built in 1924 and originally did like vaudeville, and then they kind of, you know, as some of you may know, eventually migrated to a drop-down screen, and then they put the wall up and divided it. And I mean, to think about something that was built in 1924, I mean, we are coming up on 100-year, like 100-year-old building. I mean, that is, we learned, we joined the League of Historic American Theaters, and it was a great opportunity to network with other small town and or even large theaters that are historic, that are really, you know, a lot of people, what do we have that other theaters don't? Well, we have the fact that we have a 100-year-old building and that we've restored it, and it's really a source of pride, and people want to come, like those folks, people want to come to a small town and see something that they can't experience. You can't experience that at a AMC theater. And we really got, what we didn't have maybe in that first year was just the right resources and the connections we needed to really say, you know, thousands of people have done this before, so we don't have to recreate the wheel, but how do we make it unique to Rochester? So we're obviously very passionate about this project and grateful to Terry for helping us kind of navigate this, and grateful to you all for consideration of applying for this grant, because it would be critical, clearly.
Well, and you realize that Renee's grandmother right there, was your great-grandmother, played for silent movies in that theater. Played the piano for silent movies.
Yeah.
Lots of history there.
And if you, again, so sorry, but we had, like, you know, we have a 7-member board, and we just kind of all went around and said, why are you here? What is the appeal? And every single person was really, they had a memory or they had a connection piece to it, and I would be willing to bet, should we say that in this meeting tonight, everybody has some sort of memory. For me, I didn't grow up here, but it was the first musical theater my children ever went into, and they thought it was the greatest thing they'd ever seen. So, you know, there's to be able to do something like that, or remember it was maybe your first date or something like that, to just see it sitting there so vacant. I just think if we could work together, take one small step, that's going to be a couple years and it's going to be a lot of money, but really, I think it could be kind of the cornerstone that we need along with the 9th Main project, just to say we're worth doing something more.
Yeah. So. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anybody questions? What are you looking for tonight, Terry?
I need the council to suggest and approve application or to serve as the applicant for the grant.
I do need to make one comment, and you can correct me if I'm wrong. If we apply for this OCRA grant, we are not eligible to apply for any other because we can only have one OCRA grant open
at a time. Yeah.
So just so everybody is aware, in all areas that we're looking at
right.
grants.
You're not able to apply for another one until this one gets to the start of construction.
Does that include also the DEG though? Because that's not.
No, this is CDBG,
only
federal funds.
Oh, for CDBG. Yeah.
What this really blocks the city from doing is applying for another PFP, or Public Facilities Program grant, for 7 years. So if you wanted to think about federal funds for some other type of public facility, whether it's community resource center or fire station or those kind of things, then that would kick you out of eligibility for 7 years. Just under Public Facilities Program. Doesn't restrict us on Main Street revitalization, doesn't restrict us on wastewater, stormwater. What are the other ones, Amy?
Those are just CDBG, but like DEG is just Indiana Main Street. Yeah, those don't.
That's good to know, but this is before us right now, and I think we all agree this is a really important part of the downtown, so I think it's something we need to turn our focus to.
Okay. Well, in our facility situation, thank goodness it's in pretty good shape. I don't see the fire station being built in the next 7 years.
No, but it's just
right
something
now.
That you like.
Darn it, huh?
No, it's just something I want you guys to be aware of. So if anything comes before you again,
right.
under OCRA, there we can have more than one thing open.
Terry,
yes.
Do they need to alleviate the slum and blight as well as?
Yeah, we talked about that. They can't do that tonight, but we only need that by September 1st. So Andy's going to work on the paperwork on that and bring the paperwork, and then they can vote on that at the next meeting. That'll be plenty of time. Thank you, Howard.
Would anyone?
I'll make that motion. We serve as applicant.
I second.
It's been moved and seconded that we serve as the sponsor for the grant application for this project, the OCRA grant project, signified by raising your right hand if you approve, and that's 4-0. We're on board.
So the public, thank you very much, guys. And I know you guys want to say thanks. They're all going like
thank
this.
You.
So the public hearing will be again here July 5th, 6 p.m. So we'll hopefully we'll have a nice turnout of the public, and use that to leverage.
I'd like to have this other partner here that they can come also, right, Shadow? We wouldn't.
I'm sorry, what?
We have to advertise, it's going to be advertised, but they can still come. Everybody.
Council members.
Council, they could, but we could, if the majority of you will be here to be safe, we could advertise.
Okay.
I cannot be here.
Okay.
I can't be here.
Okay. You might as well advertise it.
Yes.
Also, as the board works also, because they probably would like to attend.
Yeah, good. The other piece of business that I need some council consideration on is I was contacted by a developer who's interested in the Bailey's Harbor building downtown. What he would like to do with it is restore it, seal it up, and then also get the 5 or 6 apartments on the second floor. But his concern is he's afraid that he's going to have to tell his future residents that there's a city parking lot right behind the medical clinic that has a sign up that says 24-hour parking. So his concern is he can't tell his residents that they can park in a city lot. So if they pull in on a Friday night at 5:30 and, you know, they've got to move their car by 5:30 on Saturday morning. So.
How old is that sign, Chief Schatz?
Which sign?
Behind the medical clinic, Hoss Clinic there in the parking lot that says 24-hour parking only.
I have no idea.
It's 12-hour, right? That's got to be ancient. Or 12-hour.
Yeah, the paint on it is severely faded.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think it's being torn, but it's erected. And then also on Main Street, yeah, and I talked to Lenny about this, we have the no parking from 2 a.m. to 5 a.m., so you know, or your vehicle will be towed, which the mayor and I talked about this earlier.
That's for street sweeping.
And plowing.
And plowing.
So there are times where that's critical, 2 to 5, but there are a lot of times where it's not. So his request was basically if he's going to invest money in the property, and it'd be a significant amount of investment to attract residential development downtown, we're going to need to look at a couple of parking situations, one being 12-hour parking in a lot that's not important.
Does anybody up here see any reason why we can't take that sign down? It's been up since 1960, I would guess.
It is supported by ordinance.
Yes.
Yes, is it? Okay.
Ordinance too. Because.
Okay, so we would have to.
The one at 7th and Madison is also 12-hour parking, supported by ordinance.
Anybody see any reason we couldn't have?
And the other one I was going to say, the other ordinance support you have is the front of the business parking that was passed not too long ago to limit parking residential upstairs in front of the businesses on Main Street. So.
But that's during business hours, right?
I don't remember how it's worded. I'd have to pull it.
I thought that was during business hours, but
I know there was some conversation. The council, there was a lot of conversation with the council, but I'm not going to say for sure.
Okay.
We'd have to pull it and review it.
And I know for myself, and I've had some conversations, I had a conversation with Alyssa Troutman and her husband, because they live downtown, and a couple other people my car is either at the chamber or over on the other side, and I probably should have gotten my car towed like about a million times, but I don't know where else to park, where I can, I don't really have an offloading thing to go to put things into my apartment, and then I don't know where I would be, should park. So Ryan Fitzwater and I spoke about it, and he just said, you know, do the best you can to honor the request of the parking. But I know myself, I feel comfortable because Ryan Fitzwater gave me that, you know, moving ahead. But when I was talking to Liz and her husband, a few other folks, and obviously this gentleman, if we do encourage downtown living, which is why I moved downtown, because I think it's essential for folks our age and, you know, for others, I think the parking situation, it would be helpful for there to be some sort of clarity and forward movement with that to give some structure as to what, who, and how. So
yeah, the potential developer is not looking for designated spaces or anything like that. It's just that there's a sign right out front that says your car will be towed, and that's enforced, then okay, if that's what we need, okay. And then the 12-hour parking in the public block, again, very old sign, doesn't seem to be enforced. He said, you know, I just, if I've got a potential tenant, I don't want them to have to park two blocks away or half a block away and carry the groceries and things like that. So.
Gee, when was the last time we issued a parking citation?
We typically don't. We try to resolve it before it gets to that. But conversely to that, I have had businesses complain about people living specifically in the 800 block of Main that are parking and taking up parking spaces where, and you know, shoppers or customers can't park because people living upstairs are parking there. It's a double-edged sword, and I see both sides. I honestly do, and we don't. To my own fault, yeah, we're not strict on that because I mean we're dealing with people that number one live above the businesses plus customers and the business owners. So I mean we want to try to accommodate both parties the best we can.
I think there can be a resolution. I don't know what that looks like.
figure it out.
Because I think it's essential to have folks live downtown. Because those
it
are
is,
built-in,
absolutely.
Built-in customers, but then at the same time, the business owners have the right, because they either rent or you know, have paid for that building to be able to have that. So I don't have a magic solution.
And I think the ordinance does say that residents living above downtown businesses can't park there during business hours, I think from 8 to 5.
Cannot
park.
It's actually, Andy, just 7 to 8.
7 a.m.
to 8 p.m.
Okay, that's a bigger problem.
Yeah, because that's hard.
Yeah, I mean, that's
not going to encourage people to live downtown.
Yeah, and it's hard. It's a hard thing. It's a hard situation.
Why don't we table this and we'll pull those ordinances right for our next council meeting? It sounds like we need some attention, at least on the one.
That's good enough for me to get. That's good enough for me to get back to the council and say we're making some action.
We're going to make some decision. Else, Terry.
How much time do I have?
Jeez.
You don't want to get out of time.
Yes, that's all for tonight. Oh, it's all good. It's all good. Thank you. Okay. And that concludes our committee's report.
That's fine.
Back to Mason. Back to Mason.
I'll change to
Mason on the park board.
All right. We met on the 12th at 6 p.m. Other than what Lenny already went over. They also clearly the disc golf baskets are up. Right now you have kind of spray painted in the grass, the tees and holes, right?
Yep.
Like I said, we're gonna figure out some sort of signage in the near future on that. Order two more cameras, security cameras for the park. That was about it for the rest of Lenny's report. From Lori Simpson at the pool. This number was pretty impressive to me. The first 2 weeks they're open from May 27th to June 11th, they raised $16,290, had over 3,000 swimmers.
Isn't that amazing?
That's good.
3,000 individual customers within a 2 week period. I thought that was pretty impressive. They had a bad main valve and a bearing going out in one of the main pumps. They replaced the valve and that company put a loaner motor on the pump. So they're going to try to repair that motor and hopefully not have to buy a new one. That was it from the pool.
And the diving board.
Oh, yeah. And right before our budget meeting, the diving board was broken. So they ordered a new diving board this past week.
Did we get that turbine one out of there?
Yeah. Yes,
they had it roped off and they were going to. As soon as they could get in the bodies, moorings, and
happen. Yeah, we disposed of it.
Okay, thanks.
All right, then from Lyle at the golf course, our year-to-date total revenue is $128,540. That's up from the past 3 years. It's a little below 2013, and it's about $20,000 under 2012. So we're trending in the right direction, but we're still a little ways behind 12 and 13. Notable events coming up. We have the Fulton County Animal Shelter Tournament on July 8th, Saturday. Do you know what time that is?
No, I can't tell you also.
Okay. All right. And that is it.
Report. Okay. Any questions for Mason? Thank you. Councilman Smith of DCA and Council on Aging.
I'll do Council on Aging first. Met yesterday. Unfortunately, I could not be at the meeting, but it was a very short one. Anyway, Rusty was not there from Transpo, and the RSV report was basically about the trips coming up that are planned to Shipshawana and to place out east on the shore, not the Jersey Shore. Is that? But anyway, then on the Council of Aging side, basically the conversation was all about the parking area and how much an improvement to the facility that is, and a big thank you to everybody for that. And then a report on their golf outing, which was very successful, netting somewhere around $7,000, give or take a couple of hundred bucks. But so a very successful golf outing, 17 T teams and a lot of other donations. On the zoning, that meeting is tomorrow evening. They again have a very interesting meeting in front of them, five items, and it's a little bit different. Their agenda, the first is a fence, second is a garage, the third is a gazebo, and the fourth is the pilot travel center. Needs a variance on some lighting, height of lighting poles, and plantings, believe it or not, that are around the building. We have a 30-foot height limit on lighting, and they need about 33 feet to keep their all of their lot lit. And then some plantings that I didn't, they need to be within 10 feet of the building, of the foundation, and they need to have some that are 12 feet away from the foundation. So pretty simple stuff, but I thought it was interesting they were on the agenda already. And then another fence to deal with. But any questions, that's my report.
Anything for Councilman Smith? Thanks, Marty. Solid Waste and Animal Adoption Center, Chase.
So the golf outing that Mason was talking about, registration is at 6:30 to 8, with a start at 8 a.m. and a lunch is from 12 or 12:30. And then on the solid waste board, since our last board meeting, the recycling center shipped 88.1 tons of recyclables with a value of $9,836.31. For the month of April 2017, County Line Landfill received 31,818.13 tons of waste in 22 and a half working days for a daily average of 1,414 tons per day. Fulton County accounted for 5,483 tons. The rest of Indiana contributed 26,333 tons. There was 1.3 tons of out-of-state trash collected, and the district host fee for the month was $40,873.53. The county host fee for the month of April was $13,167.34. So far, they've sold a total of 1,639 orange bags, of which 796 were purchased by city residents and 853 were purchased by county residents. And so far, I've collected $1,062 for the disposal of bulk items. We ended up approving a new purchase for a roll-off dumpster from Jason Group at the Rochester Iron and Metal for $2,350. That's about it. We did get the hood painted on our tractor. It was a New Holland tractor that we decided to sell. We painted the hood and detailed it. Looks really nice. So we're going to try to sell that. Actually, we're going to try to sell that to the county. Is that still in the works? The
county's looking at it. What would have to be done to be able to do that? It might even be something to transfer. I think they first and foremost have to decide if they want it. Commissioner Ranstead, who has a lot of experience in that area, says it's most of the time not a good idea to get into something like that. It's usually cheaper to buy new than it is to get something like that that's had that much activity with it. They were going to check on it. I might as well let everyone know that there was another issue that came up, and that was regarding the contract. We had quite a bit of discussion regarding the contract between the Republic and the county and how payment is made for the trash distribution out there, and the district host fee, how that's established, and the county's part of that, how that's established. And this contract, the original contract, was made in 1996. It's had four addendums since that time, and at least three different parties to deal with. Started with Allied
waste disposal, and today is Republic. I'm of the ilk, and I spoke at the county council meeting here a few weeks ago, that we need to go through this contract from top to bottom. It's quite lengthy. Councilman Heller and I are meeting on July the 11th to go through it. I've got several questions as to how the payouts are being made. And really, there's been no sit-down with anybody since Allied Waste to go through that contract. Like I said, we've had at least three different hands now who are responsible to the county for that contract. We need to make sure everybody's of the same understanding of how these monies are being paid. We may find some money there that we didn't know about. Anyway, we're doing some due diligence there. And that, like I said, will be done by July the 11th. And then the plan would be to sit down with the Republic and, you know, go through, here's what we interpret this to be, what's your interpretation? So make sure we're all on the same page. Anything question-wise for Chase? Okay. We've gone through everything.
You got three hats tonight.
You are you speaking for Sarah, are you?
Well, she had asked me to, but maybe why Amy is here, I'm not sure.
Doesn't matter,
I'd be happy to. Okay. She, go ahead. Yes, I'm wearing multiple hats tonight.
Okay, for the Rochester Downtown Partnership. Shot at.
I'm actually, basically,
who's a member of that board?
Yes, I am the vice president of that board. And basically, really what she, I'm going to bring the text up so I make sure I don't forget anything. But Sarah Reese was unable to be here this evening, who is the executive director. And she, a couple of things we've got going on, and Mason can speak to this as well. They've got a couple of projects they're looking at doing with some bikes and some benches. And we spoke about that at our last board meeting, and we're still trying to get that finalized and get that project hopefully moving forward soon and looking at revenue and cost and all of that stuff. So it's kind of exciting because it's actually hopefully going to, again, it's that visual point in downtown, something people can physically touch, visibly see, and kind of stir that, like you talked about the couple with Giretti's. And then the other thing she wanted me to make sure I mentioned was the Living Local Festival. And this is the first year in many, many years that we have had a parade and on a Saturday followed by a small festival. From the RDP's perspective, the festival accomplished exactly what we wanted it to. The goal was to bring in local, we call them foodies. but to bring in some local food vendors, local crafters that people may not know are around here. We were not targeting the food trucks. We did not target those folks intentionally because we were trying to make it about the locals. Like I said, again, the ones that we don't know about. And we had two brand new folks that are newer to the area and are getting ready, one of them being our new restaurant that will be opening hopefully in August, I believe.
August, yeah.
And the other one was a barbecue. I forget, the name just jumped right out of my head.
His name is Georgiano's.
Georgiano, thank you. It went right out of my head as soon as I started to say it. And they've been here about a year, but they typically will do like motorcycle festivals and things like that, but oh my. Food was really good. And then of course Sally's was there, and Putz did a beer garden, so he was able to bring in, and there was actually a group of motorcycle group that came in, riders, and they went, ate lunch and left. And we had a small string band there, did a really good job, three of them, and they played for a couple of hours. And it was just nice. It was a relaxing event, if I could say that for an event.
The bill of fare for the Cuban restaurant.
Yes. And and I was going to say the Cuban restaurant was the one that they will be opening in August, but they sold out first.
At 12:30.
Yes. They were the first one to sell out of their food that day. So I think we've got some great things coming from them as far as the new restaurant coming in. And then make sure I didn't miss anything. That was really all she wanted to, oh, and the facade grants. We're going to be making a change on our facade grants. Before, we've been doing a cutoff deadline, and in conversations with Community Foundation and some other Main Street programs, we are finding that it probably is better to make that a, basically a continuous grant process. So there's, you know, somebody can come in, apply for an awning or a small facade grant, and we're just going to continue that as opposed to having cutoff deadlines, so that the work can just keep progressing, because obviously it's hard to get contractors, and some of the deadline stuff can be challenging, especially if you're having an awning made and hitting, you know, make sure your vendors can get that stuff done. So my thinking.
Yes, and then Mason is working with IUK. We had the MOU that showed up to do that IUK MBA students to do the leakage study and market analysis for us. And then today, we actually heard about a potential partnership with tourism, and then Chrissy from the promotions committee to receive a 50-50 match to do some videos for not only downtown Rochester to promote, but also for Fulton County. So that is something that came in about 3 o'clock. So that is new, but we were waiting to hear that. So I called Chrissy about it to see, you know, what her thoughts were. So the opportunity to be able to create those videos to put on the Rochester Downtown Partnerships website or tourism website, or to put anywhere or to use. So that's something that's potentially in the works too.
Okay. Any questions for Amy or Shana? Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
I think I know.
Well,
got to warn out.
We don't have any ADA concerns. Any legal things to throw out? Any?
I just want to reiterate annually, as part of our agreement to serve as city attorney, I do attend the Indiana Municipal Lawyers Association conference, which I went to Thursday and Friday. Interesting ideas, lots of cities and towns had issues with weeds and problem properties and chickens. So I'd be happy to know that you're not one of the issues that's sprang out of that is the idea of pursuing problem properties in litigation with more than one plaintiff to get some economies of scale and also to force some leverage. For example, when we sue someone under the unsafe building ordinance, the city is the sole plaintiff. If we wanted to, there's no reason we couldn't bring a joint city-county litigation if there were also health code violations, and bring one complaint to kind of work together as a team on something. So that's something I'd like to explore a little bit. Maybe we'll be able to.
Does that add more credence to what you're doing, or more clout to the process?
It certainly adds more teeth to the process, because you have the ability to, in one lawsuit, you can cite someone for violating both city and county ordinances, and you kind of cast a broader net, and that may be a useful tool for us down the line. I think I've done that. So.
Great. Anything to ask Andy? Please. Yes, sir.
Are you taking questions from the audience? Or?
Well, we've got to move into our ordinance here. And
then after that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is it
pertinent to city business, yes.
Pardon me?
It's pertinent to city business, yes. I thought you asked me a question.
Okay. We move on down to the ordinances and resolutions. We've got one ordinance on the schedule tonight. It's ordinance 03-2017. Dealing with bicycles on city or protected property. And this originates with some issues we've been having all through town. Cheap shots, and the department had to deal with several issues regarding some specific groups of young folks who were riding their bicycles on private properties and doing some very dangerous things. Actually, I see a property owner sitting in the audience tonight, Mr. Betcher, who owns the
the old Roski's house over on 9th Street that he's revamping and redoing. Would you like to stand, Dan, and identify yourself and tell a little bit about what's happening over there at your property?
I'm Dan Betcher. I own that property there on 9th Street. I got a call one day that there was kids riding bikes and hopping off the back porch. It was under construction and I didn't have it fenced off or anything. I was going to be doing some concrete work. But it's just a dangerous thing, and I, being out of town, you don't have any way of controlling it. And I ask for, I mean, you patrol as much as you can, but sometimes it's a little unsafe. And I don't know if it's up to the parents or who it's up to, but a little bit dangerous, and it could cause me a problem or the kids.
Andy, would you like to speak towards that? You've had quite a bit of experience.
This has been an ongoing problem since it started getting warm. There for a while, we were getting two or three calls a day with kids riding on business property, doing tricks on the courthouse steps while at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on a weekday. So we had a meeting, the mayor and I had a meeting with Andy Burgess just to talk about our options. We've confiscated bikes and told the parents to come get them, and then we get accused of harassing our kids. So we have other better things to do than worry about kids on bikes, but these are the things we're getting calls to.
Well, we have had an incident where there was an accident while the construction was going on at 9th and Main. We had a young man down there doing some jumps, hit his head, and had stitches out of the hospital. So, I mean, we're trying to be proactive on this. These businesses and private properties are not bicycle parks.
We have a bicycle park. We told the kids their biggest complaint is it's not good enough. And they want us to give it to them. They want us to do something about it. We've instructed them, hey, look, get your parents, go to the parks board meeting, come up with funding ideas, make it better, and to no avail. I don't enjoy having to come up with an ordinance because that's why every ordinance is created, because of one or two people.
And I guess that brings up that Terry and I are talking about thinking about the future with bicycles. We are obviously bringing, or he is, with the nickel plate, bringing bicyclists downtown. If you put actual bike racks on a place that says no bicycles welcome, but then you have this other issue, that's kind of a conflict of...
It is, and they can have bicycles downtown, they just can't ride them on the sidewalks.
Yeah, so looking at what that looks like, because there are folks that do, because they were, poor Lenny, they were using his, I saw them at 1 o'clock in the morning, or someone else saw them, told me that they saw them at 1 o'clock in the morning using that beautiful new stage as a ramp. I did not see that, neither did the police officers. I talked to Jim, Officer Reason about it, but somebody had seen them at 1 o'clock in the morning using that. So it's that balance between, we want bicyclists who are actually responsible to be able to come down and use that, but you don't want these young folks who are choosing to misuse their bicycle.
We had a homeowner
at 1 in the morning.
Yeah.
So why are they bicycling at 1 in the morning?
That would be a question to the parents, I think, because I don't know either. But there were, I think, a group of 5 of them that were out at 1 o'clock in the morning using the stage as a ramp.
And somebody's going to get hurt. It's just a matter of time. We had one homeowner that they were going off his diving board in his backyard, you know. It's just, we've got to have some
balance between
some
folks
balance
who misuse
there.
It.
You're right, that's
right.
The
yeah.
That's so that is, like the chief said, we met the other day and put together an ordinance or revised an ordinance, came up with a different bicycle ordinance for downtown, and it's ordinance 03-2017. And Councilman Goodman, if you, I'd entertain a motion to have the first read ordinance 3-2017
in its entirety. I move to read in its entirety.
Second. Those in favor?
Ordinance number 03-2017, an ordinance regarding bicycles in the city or protected property. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester has determined that certain portions of the city's ordinances regarding use of bicycles on certain city or protected property should be amended. Now therefore be it ordained by the Common Council of the City of Rochester, the following sections of the Municipal Code of the City of Rochester be amended. Section 98.01 is hereby amended as follows, additions in bold. Definition: for the purpose of this section, protected property is defined as any business, church, organization, city property, or other property accessed by the public, excluding parks. Section 98.04 is hereby amended as follows. Repeatedly driving through parking area, dangerous bicycle riding, prohibited. A, it shall be a violation of the section for any person to drive a motor vehicle repeatedly through any parking area provided access to a protected property without transacting business. B, it shall be a violation of the section for any person to ride a bicycle on a protected property or private property in a manner other than for transportation, including stunts, tricks, performance riding, or any manner that presents increased danger, risk, or hazard to the rider or bystanders beyond normal bicycle transportation without the permission of the property owner.
Mr. Mayor, before you proceed to second reading, a couple of things. I did not realize until I walked in today that you wouldn't be able to pass this ordinance today because you only have four members of the council here.
That's correct.
So you have introduced it, but you have an ordinance that says if you pass it at the same meeting where it's introduced, you need a two-thirds majority, so you can't do that. And you also have an ordinance that says you can only do a second reading by title only if you have a unanimous consent of two-thirds. So if you read a second time, you actually have to read it in its entirety. So you might want to consider either tabling it now you have first reading, tabling second, third reading for future meeting. You could do it at a special meeting, and if only four of you show up for the next special meeting, as long as it's noticed, you can pass it.
Yeah, I forgot that also. Yeah. Yeah.
Second. Those in favor? 4-0.
The 11th, the budget meeting?
The 11th,
yes.
Is the budget meeting.
Do you want to eat now? So I will practice. I'll work on it.
Record yourself.
Yeah,
we can do it.
Second budget mayor?
I haven't advertised it.
Is it? Do we need to do it by the other? Is there any?
No, not right now.
We're okay.
We could wait till the next meeting.
Good. Yeah.
So what should you do? Are we doing it on the 11th? We're going to wait till our next
meeting? We're going to wait till the next meeting.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You had something for the council?
Yes. My name is Paul Fleischman. Forgive me for not standing. I've got a medical condition.
No problem, Paul.
Prior to your election, the previous mayor, Smiley, and the city council they appropriated tens of thousands of dollars to hire an engineering firm to do the storm sewer study. Are you aware of that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And that was tried, I believe, out of Indianapolis.
Yes.
Well, part of their study involved soil, I was here for the meetings, soil tests and survey. Why are we doing it again?
That was done at a different time. It was a different project. We're doing a portion of the storm sewer. We're not doing the whole city at this time. So we're going through and rechecking that section that we're going to do and make sure that all of our T's are crossed and our I's are dotted.
Well, I don't understand. What did we pay the other company for? They did, according to their report, exactly what you're doing now.
The company that we're using right now has gone through that report thoroughly, and they have deemed it necessary to do these checks that they're doing right now. They have seen the triad.
I'm sorry?
They have seen the triad report and gone through it thoroughly, but have deemed that there are certain areas they need to do some checking on, and that's what they're doing.
Well, we paid triad for something we didn't get. Is that what you're telling me?
We paid Triad for a project that didn't get carried forward, yes.
Well, again, one of these two surveys was unnecessary.
I'm not sure that. Like I said, the engineering firm we're dealing with has been through the Triad report and has utilized some of the information from
What caused you to bring in another concern? Another engineering outfit? I mean, the surveying was done, the soil tests were done, and we're doing it over again. That's my question. Not the substrata, but none of that. But what made you bring this outfit in?
Just my choice of engineering firms.
I'm sorry?
My choice of engineering firms. That was my decision.
To back up or to do what? To try it?
To use the Donahue folks to make the evaluations that we needed to make to break ground to go forth with the project. And we started with the Triad study. They took it apart and took a look at it and then picked out what they thought was necessary to go through and move forward with the project.
Well, again, it begs the question, somebody got paid for not doing their job, in my estimation.
Well, we have full confidence in the folks that we're dealing with now. Not saying the Triad folks didn't do a good job, just saying that's not the engineering firm that I chose when we went down the road for this project, but I did take their information and shared it with the engineering firm that we are dealing with. And they came through with, this is the process we need to take to move forward.
Okay, well, it's not okay, but in your local column, you're talking about the storm sewer utility. I was here that night when they didn't even know we had one. Council, that is. Burns Bank brought it up. Nobody knew anything about it.
Yeah,
but now we find out it's a 10-year-old deal, right?
No, it's longer than that.
Okay, but it hasn't been enforced in 10 years.
There were never any rates established. The ordinance to establish the utility was put into place in 2001. But then the next steps to move forward were never done.
Well, this is probably for the city attorney more than, I mean, that thing has died 10 years ago. If you're gonna impose fees, I think you will probably need to have more meetings. Publish it before you enforce any monetary. You see where I'm going?
I see what you're saying. I mean,
it died of old age.
Well,
you need to bring it up again.
I don't know. The decision to make a utility dies of old age. It's on the books.
But it was never enforced.
Do you have any thoughts on that?
No, not without further research on it.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I didn't.
He said he'd have to research that, Paul.
Okay.
I mean, are you asking me to research that question?
Please.
Okay.
Yeah.
Happy to.
And then at the next council meeting, we can visit this again.
We can certainly hear a report from him on that. Yeah.
Yeah. Because something that old that hasn't been enforced, I mean, you have to go back and have hearings again. In my estimation, and I think that's what council will find out.
Now, there would be public hearings at the establishment of the rates. That's part of the process.
No, but prior to establishing the rates.
Yes, but I'm not sure that an ordinance to establish utility ever dies. I don't know. That's something we're going to have to take a look at.
Okay, and
now,
can we put that on agenda for next meeting?
Yeah, we can do that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second. Those in favor, we're in adjourn.